Welcome to Videvote Church. Today we're studying in the book of James. We've been looking at and examining James literally, word by word, almost figuratively, line by line, and certainly examining the precepts, the concepts, the things that make us understand the Word of God by the Spirit of God to the people of God, of the Son of God, Jesus. What that means is that here at Videvote Church, we like to say that I'm not teaching you anything you don't already know or that you can't already learn, but that the Spirit of God who dwells within you, He can teach you all things. He can lead you into all truth. He will make this written word become the veritable living Word of God, as though God spoke it into existence and it was so, by way of His Spirit, causing your spirit to bear witness and to receive the things of the Spirit by hearing, seeing, knowing, understanding, and applying that which is true from the Bible. Because the Bible itself isn't perfect. Matter of fact, it's a collection. But what God does is He takes what is written there and by His Spirit applies it to you, interprets it to you, causes it to come to you in a way that it is God speaking directly to you. Now, I know what you're thinking is that, well, no, it's infallible. Well, no, it's not. It's literal, but not infallible. It's something that is written by man, inspired by God, that God can use. Because God can use a donkey. God can use a cat. God could use a bird. God could use, just speaking right out of this thin air, God could come to you as an angel. He could come to you as the Son of God. He could come to you in the Word of God. Bluntly, for me, God comes to me in a variety of ways so that I can share those experiences with people today who are looking for and trying to understand what is it about these Christians that makes them Christ-like. How come they can have peace when I'm at odds with the president, or I'm at odds with the Congress, or I'm at odds with my wife, or I'm fighting with my dog, my cat, my job, or I'm really at odds with myself? Well, mankind has been at odds with God for a long time, and God has been revealing Himself to man since man was created. Since that time, we have been given certain ways and means that we can study and learn of God. One of those means is James, and we've been studying in the book of James from being the point of view that James was the brother of Jesus, and James didn't know what he was doing when he knew Jesus personally. Jesus grew up with James, and James just didn't get what was going on with his brother. Some people would say half-brother. Well, you know, I had half-sisters, but I never called them half-sisters. And to this day, if I called my sister a half-sister, my mother would come back from the dead and kill me. Seriously. But having said that, we are thankful to God that we've been given cameras, I guess, now to apply better technology so that we can do things in a more explicit and implicit way. What I just did now for those who are watching is that I zoomed in from a camera that's located over here. Sometimes it'll be over here, sometimes over there, who knows where it'll be, that we're using to promote, broadcast, and demonstrate the reality of our experience with God, that we call it broadcast Christianity, but really what it is just simply proclaiming who Jesus is through videos. We call it Videvo, and that's why this is Videvo Church. Videvo means simply video devotionals, and we say that lots of times because when we restart a series, or we renew a year, or we become to a place where we're growing in studying and applying the scriptures, because Jesus is coming again so soon that He's right around the corner, that He's knocking at your door, that should you but stop and look and listen, you could hear His voice, that you know that any time between 2017 and 2034, Jesus is coming. Jesus could come anytime during that time period, and that it's an 80% probability that it will happen for you and to you. We call it the event, others call it the rapture. We also know that there's a 90% probability that between the years 2030 and 2034 that Jesus is knocking at the door. 90% probability that the Son of Man could return between the years 2030 and 2040. Now, obviously, I'm the type of person who likes to say, hey, the sooner the better. So I'm kind of like in the 2017 through 2034 routine. I do know that if you do not prepare yourself, you will not go in the rapture. I know if you are not looking for the return of the King, you will not be in the event that he's going to snatch you away. I do know that if you do not listen to his voice, you will be deceived, and you will march yourself into the Valley of Megiddo without realizing you're going to hell. Such as it is, James had made a mistake. James had denied the only begotten Son of God. James had actually been a stumbling block, or not stumbling block to, well, he'd been a stumbling block to his own brethren, I mean, and his sisters, because they were related to Jesus, and they too did not believe until after the Holy Spirit was given, until after Jesus had risen from the dead, until he had been given a personal experience that could not be denied. Then James became who we see here in the scriptures. And so we've been reading through James, and we've been through James chapter 1, verses 5 through 12. We had already gone through verses 5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally, and abradeth not, and it shall be given unto him. We had gone through 6, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. Only that's still where we're at. We're still in verse 6. Because we had said previously in our last study, but let him ask in faith. And we studied about what in faith meant, what in faith is, what in faith is applying to us as God by his Spirit wants us to be in the faith, but also in faith. So now we're going to look at today. It's verse 6, the second half that says, nothing wavering. Interesting is there's a comma there in the English, then it says nothing wavering. Now, I'm not going to say that every grammatical point in the English applies directly to the grammatical points that are the yud and the tittle that Jesus described as far as not being removed from the law until all things be fulfilled, but I'm going to say that. Because, you see, here at Videville Church, we exercise what's called integral specificity. That means the specific integer with which the context is relating to that particular integer is necessary for the content to be contextual in the volume as well as in the integer. In other words, what applies intricately in this minutiae applies to the macro volume, and you cannot take one part out without applying all parts in it. So we don't see God being studied like systematic theology. We see God revealing himself through the Word by it being all of the Word. You can't take an Old Testament or a New Testament apart. You have to have all parts working cohesively, cooperatively, and inclusively all together as integers of a dynamic, you could say, ribonucleic acidic type of chromosomal detail that we see in what integers specifically is designed and recorded to be when we look at integral specificity. If you look it up in Google as far as what it applies to in the chromosomal detail of the hexoribonucleic acids that we know that make up the design of life, the order with which creation was made, the fact that we in our cell makeup have everything written down to our very atoms. And even they can be changed in some ways as we see stem cell research changing stem cells to fit whatever part is missing or needs to be regrown. My God, how amazing can that be that we can see that the very integers of life, the very integral specificity of life itself is detailed all the way down to the atomic structure. And so being such as that, that God had designed it that way, we see that the Bible is the same way. We go from the atomic to the macrocosmic, and from the macrocosmic to the microcosmic, and we take it all and we apply it to the Word, integral specificity. It is what it is, where it is, the way it is. I mean, in reality, when I did this thesis study of it, I always equated it back to rap and to the colloquial way of saying it. So in our colloquial way of describing the integers or the integral specificity of that with which is integral to its own specifics, details that God has created for us to understand and to comprehend, that means that in every detail and every little part, including the comma, we can apply the reality of God revealing himself to us. So I like that. I find it very interesting to me, specifically because it means that God is greater than anything I could ever imagine. God is always there as described by his own integers or his own details or his own word as it applies where he reveals it to us, not we study of him to describe him by doctrine or dogma or exhaustive or inclusive or expositional or preaching or teaching. No, man. I mean, that's commentary. I'd rather have him tell me who he is. And if he says, I am is not my name, I'll say, great, then what are you? And he'll say, well, what I am is I am that I am, and I am, I will be what I will be, and to my people I shall be as I am. Okay. I mean, you know, whatever God says goes. So that's the way it should be, because then you could include, literally, literalness. But you can't in systematic theology, because it wants to logically predicate everything upon a typology or a type of formatting your brain to think logic, premise, proof, demonstration. Sorry, God's already demonstrated he doesn't need logic. So in verse 6, in looking at it, we are talking about nothing wavering. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. You know, I kind of get the idea that I understand about wavering. It's kind of like, well, you know, that's a good way of describing wavering. Well, you're kind of iffy. You're kind of wishy-washy. You're kind of back and forth. You know, I know that I know that I know that, you know, the President of the United States right now, Donald Trump, newly elected in 2017, is a man that wavers to and fro like every whim of doctrine that comes by, as well as every ocean wave that he's just tossed and turned and twisted and goes with whatever's in front of him at the moment that he thinks about it. He just shoots off his mouth, talks with his mouth, and just uses whatever he can, and then covers for it because he's got money, honey, and then he's got fame, supposedly, and then he's got people that allow him that privilege of being kind of, you know, fast shuffling his way through life to get to the place of where he wants to be. A lot of millionaires are like that. Billionaires are not. You can't cross over from a certain platform that you're at to get more money until you learn how to deal with some of your own insecurities, inferiorities, and specific details of your life that show that you really aren't as wise or as smart or as intelligent as you think you are, but you need other people around you. And that's how billionaires operate. They don't operate that they're the wisest. They operate that they include the wisest. Sadly, we have a president that doesn't do that yet. He may not. We teach here at Video Church that it is the rise of the anti-president. He is not the Antichrist, can't be, he cannot be or fulfill the office or the role of the Antichrist. That man shall come from Europe. But being that he was wavering, he doesn't make solid decision choices. He says things that he doesn't do things. And Jesus doesn't allow for that when he said, look, watch the scribes and the Pharisees. They'll say one thing, but watch what they do. Listen to what they say, honor what they say, but don't do as they do. Don't be a hypocrite. If you don't agree, then don't do it. If you agree, then do it. In other words, be who you are on the inside as well as on the outside. Otherwise, you become wavering. You become back and forth. It's kind of like I married my wife, you know, and I told her the day I married her that, you know, you're going to be a Christian, but you're going to learn certain things that are true, and I'm going to give you shortcuts in how to learn those things for yourself, on your own, by yourself, with God teaching you. But one of the things you're going to find out about me is that if I say no, I don't back up. I don't back down. I don't back up. I will say no and learn the lessons of that no. What that means is that if I say no now, unless there's some specific, you know, adjunction or some other reason to change that statement, I mean no for all the 24 hours that the sun has risen and set on what I have said, meaning no. So tomorrow I may say yes, but today I say no. So you know that my no is no. You know, because I said no. But if I say yes, I don't backtrack on my yes. I will suffer the consequences of saying yes. That's the reality of being not confident, but being competent and being unwavering in the fact that you're willing to make a decision based upon your choice. And how you make that choice is for you to decide. But if you'll live through the consequences of your choice, then you are unwavering. You are as God has said He would honor by giving you wisdom, by telling you things, because you can't waver. You can't say, well, God, I want to know, and then you go, well, God ain't going to say so. Or, well, God, I want this, but no, you know, He won't do it. Or, God will do it, but you're wrong about it. And then you're not willing to change because you were wrong. Both are applicable. So it's not just simply having faith to blindly go on and buffalo your way through, or having no faith and you're wishy-washy, you know, well, maybe, you know, I think, kinda, well, all right. But rather it says that applicable to lacking wisdom, and let him ask of God a bread of thought that shall be given unto him, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. It simply means that when you're dealing with someone who's absolute God, you can't go backwards or forwards. You have to be specific, detail-oriented, because God is going to reveal in the details and manifest things you will not believe, because it'll blow your mind. He will deal with the reality of His own will be done, regardless of whether you say, thy will be done, but you should say, thy will be done, because then it helps you to remember, oh, if I don't get what I want, it's because He did what He said He would by using it anyways. That's why the Holy Spirit interprets our prayers. A lot of the things we say to God, bluntly, are blasphemous, are evil, are selfish, self-centered, disgusting, are grossly wrong. And yet God spares us being wiped out by being stupid the way we say things, by changing it. Because He gave us the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit loves on us and protects us by changing our words, intentions, and attitudes and actions, praying to God. I mean, some idiot can stand up and say, you know, God told me He's going to give you, you know, $10,000, you know, and the Holy Spirit reinterprets that and says, no, that's not what God said, but, you know, blah, blah, blah. And so God doesn't hear it necessarily the same way that the person says it. So, you know, the person isn't wiped out immediately. They will be held accountable for their words later. But we want to talk about James and nothing wavering. When you live in an everyday world, you deal with everyday realities. You have a boss, if you go to a job, and your boss says, did you do the job? Your answer is yes or no. You can tell your boss, well, and as soon as you said the well, he already knows what's coming. If you're a boss like me, I'd fire you. Because if I hired you, first of all, you would already know what I expected of you. I would expect you to do your job. Bill Belichick, I'm told, that is a coach of a football team, New England Patriots, I hope. But Bill Belichick apparently tells people in their playing their games, you know, football, as a profession, you know, they're getting paid for it, so, you know, you figure that one out. Men playing in games, to getting paid to play a game. Still don't go there, you know, it's like, nah, that just isn't right, you know, it's our rich society spending wealthy money on foolishness, you know, but anyways. So apparently he coaches people and he tells them, look, do your job. Now, Jesus himself came to us and said, this is why you're being saved. This is what you're supposed to do. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing. So he just should be able to say from James, do your job. But he warned that, look, I came and you couldn't receive the things I said. What would you do if I told you of the things in heaven that are going on? You wouldn't be able to receive them. So there's more to Christianity than sucking your thumb or sticking a finger in your ear or pretending sitting in a pew is all you do. You've got to be more than what you think you are, and God wants you to be more than what you are. Because he doesn't leave you the way you are. He doesn't accept you the way you are. He changes you from the moment you say, God, help me and save me. You were changed. That moment, your destiny is assured, but you will change to assure yourself of that destiny. You will make your calling and election sure. That is, without a doubt, the work of the Holy Spirit with you and in you and on you and about you. But you cannot leave it at, I got saved and I'm still the same way yesterday that I am today and that I will be tomorrow. Well, then you will be the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and you'll go to hell the same way that everyone else will if they don't change their ways. So the fact of the matter is that it's not enough to simply say and pretend and contend that you have faith or that you are saved, but rather it is unwavering in the sense that you have to ask God whether or not these things be so. Ask God what wisdom is. Ask God everything. Ask God and follow God to do according to what he tells you to do. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. Because if you waver, you don't want the answer. Because you know yourself what the answer is. It's something you won't do. You know that. You know that you won't do what God has told you to do because you've chosen not to accept the answer in the first place. Because if you understood who you're talking to, you know he wants what's best for you. The rest is just reality check on your own sinfulness. You can't take it with you when you die. Why are you attached to it now? God will remove it from you one way or another. So when Bill Belichick finds someone that doesn't do their job, he fires them. You know, I don't even know if he gives them the opportunity to change. I don't. I mean, I tell a person, look, this is what I hire you for. If I tell you to do something, I will explain it to you. I will demonstrate it to you. I will show you it. I will have you tell me what it is. I will have you demonstrate how you're doing it. And you will repeat it back to me what I've told you to do, how I've shown you to do it, and the fact that you are able to do it. Once we've done that, and that is called training and practice and exercising that with which I have shown you to do, if you don't do it, I will fire you. And I'm telling you right now, today, that I will do that. And so the agreement is, if you want to work for me, I will give you all the tools and abilities that you have, but you have to do your job. Because my job is to hire you, and my job is to fire you. That is the definition of heaven and hell. That is the reality of what God is doing in our life. That is the fact of what Jesus has said to us. So in James, when James is talking about nothing wavering, he's talking about presupposing some things that are already in place because he's speaking to Christians that are supposed to know these things already, to Jews who do know these things and are compromising already, to the reality of each and every one of us that has to stand before a holy God and a living God that's going to call upon us to answer for our irresponsibility. So we cannot talk to God with a question. We have to go to God with an expectation that God is going to answer bluntly, bravely, forthright, straight to you. He's going to tell you yes, no, and not maybe, but guess what? You can't have it. I'm saying to you what I want you to do. Don't go to God thinking that he's giving you, well, yes, no, maybe, or wait. That's a bunch of bull, loney. Sorry, I apologize, but it's bullshit. And I say that only because I want you to emphasize the fact that what you are saying about God is a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie. God is real. God is just. God is holy. And God is specific. God has never said, well, maybe. No, God tells you what to do. God speaks to you directly. God doesn't say, hey, you know what, maybe if you pray about it, you know, and you do 20 Hail Marys, and you do a couple of these, you know, Our Fathers, and you genuflect and reflect, and, you know, bow and bob and weave, you know, and keep every bone moving in your body, then I'll go ahead and give you what you want. Well, if you do this, I'll do this. Well, if you do that, I'll do this. No. It is true that God loves you. It is true that you could speak to God in your own way of speaking. But this is a criteria that you want wisdom. You're asking from someone who knows what you don't know. And in order to get what he's got, you got to ask him according to his way of applying to you what he's going to tell you. When you waver, you wouldn't accept what he had to say anyways because you wouldn't believe it was true. God might say to you, bluntly, go, take now thy son, thine only son, and I'll show you the mountain where you'll kill him. I don't think that was the Lord. No, you know what? I came from a people like that. My God would not do that. I'm sorry. I may be Abraham, but you know, I am not sure that this is the word of the Lord. I am not at all comfortable with this God, so I know I'm not going to accept that that's you. I'm going to say, hey, you know what? I'll think about it for a while, and then I'll let you know whether or not I think that's you speaking or whether or not it's really the word. I think I'll go find some other counselor, you know, to advise me what's really true here, you know, because obviously, I wouldn't do something like that. Really. You see, that's what nothing wavering means. Being real. Because seriously, you're not being real. If you're going to God and asking for wisdom, you're being real. But if you're not willing to accept the answers or what he may say, you're not serious. You're playing with God. And you're going to get burned. So, in James doesn't mince words because he knows what it's like to have been wrong. Paul, the same way, knew what it was right to sell out all the way for God. To give everything he has and all of his energy and zeal that failed him for God. Both men made a gross error in where they place their unwaveringness. We know that based upon integral specificity, it's all of it connected together. That means you can't just say unwaveringly have faith or not question, but it says, who are you asking before you ask? You have to qualify and quantify what it is you're doing so that you understand why the reality of asking unwaveringly, or to be able to say to him, let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, because nothing is nothing and wavering is wavering, so you can't even have even an ounce of it, because you already know that God is going to come through and tell you. You know he's going to do what he says. You know that even if you don't understand it like Abraham, even Abraham had to add something. Well, I don't know what's going to happen, but I know that, you know, even if, you know, I kill my son, you know, I'll still have him because it's basically an eternity. And I don't think that, you know, some of the Christians apply it a little differently and try to make it sound like it's, well, Abraham knew, of course, that he's going to, you know, come back even if resurrected from the dead. No, I wouldn't make it quite a step of faith. You know, I think faith wasn't in the fact that he was going to get his son. Faith was in the trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not in your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him and he'd direct your path. That's faith. The other part is interpretation of trying to make application of something that they are pulling out of context to try to make it fit so they explain this idea of God challenging Abraham. Sorry. No. That's not the way it goes. Unwavering is literally nothing wavering. Not an ounce, not an inch, not a mile. So, you know, I mean, you could make a case and you could try to make the case for, you know, false prophets like Muhammad or Joseph Smith or others that have, you know, been oh so confident that they were willing to, you know, get killed for their faith. But they were demonstrating that to other people. You see, God doesn't say die for your faith when you're asking him a question. God doesn't say die to the world when you're asking a question. He just says, hey, come to me. Nothing wavering. In other words, I'm going to tell you something. You might not be ready for it, but you need to be ready before you come and ask me. So I always like to say this whenever I'm praying or whenever I'm talking about things like this or whenever I'm saying, hey, we live by in this ministry, and that's why we teach this one in depth. We live by this ministry, James 1:5, that if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who breedeth up and give to all men liberally, because we have that nothing wavering. There's no doubt that God told you. You didn't want to hear it. You didn't want to do it. You don't want to believe it. You don't want to accept it. So guess what? That's why you're not doing it. But as far as our ministry is concerned, in knowing Jesus and knowing God the Father, it is a fact. You can know wisdom. It is a fact that God has spoken to you. It is a fact that the reality of life can be understood and everything in here can be comprehended in a way that God can tell you what to do, where to go, what to say, how to live, what to be, and have applied it to you by Himself without you reading it for yourself and interpreting it by your own understanding to make it into something it is not. That was Judaism. That is Christianity expositional. That is not being led by the Spirit of God. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children of God. It doesn't take a genius. Little children can say, hey, I don't understand. Well, honey, if you just pray and ask God to give you the Holy Spirit, He'll teach you. Oh, what's the Holy Spirit? Well, it's kind of like God putting a part of Himself in you so that you can be a part of Himself. Oh, I want God in me. Well, good. That's what Jesus said. And pray. And a little child will accept that and go with it. And they will, believe it or not, read passages in Scripture and teach you. For a little child to lead them. And it's not because they have an innocence. It's because they haven't been trained to be stupid. Wisdom is justified over children. When we follow Jesus, we shouldn't follow long distance. When we say we are Christian, we shouldn't be a byline of a profession of football player and I'm a Christian, basketball player and I'm a Christian, doctor and I'm a Christian. No, I'm a Christian. I just happen to work at this job that's called being a doctor. I'm a Christian. I just happen to, you know, work at a profession that, you know, they pay me to play games, football. I'm a Christian, but I happen to be more involved in that with which God has told me to do than what the world is wanting me to do. So you see, you need to make a choice. You need to make a decision every day as you wake up every day, as the day is called today, to decide for yourself which way you will go. Will you, in the day that you are called and chosen and directed and inspected to be found a Christian because nothing wavering, you ask God for wisdom how to live your life today by trusting in the Lord with all your heart, leaning not in your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledging Him, letting Him direct your path? Or are you going to say to someone, hey, you know what? That Christian stuff, there were too many pastors. There were too many churches. There were too many people interpreting things. There were too many people telling me what to do. Then don't follow them. Why don't you do what Jesus, the Son of God, the Son of Man, has told you to do? Why don't you know what Jesus has told you to do? Why do you doubt what Jesus has told you to do? Why don't you have faith? Jesus said of Himself, in the latter days when the Son of Man returns, will He find faith? Faith is not about nothing wavering. Faith is not about not having doubts. Faith is about accepting what God said to do and doing it. Hey, there are times where, you know what? I doubt that I can believe in it, but guess what? I'll do it anyways. Because God said. It's not rocket science, as we keep saying over and over and over again. It's God's science. It is the applicable means of applying the principles of the theorem that is already demonstratively proven, and it's a fact, Jack, that it works, so you don't have to go out in science and examine it to see if it's true. You have to take the scientific principle of making applicable that with which is already means and working, like the laws of dynamics that you use in order to have an action and reaction. You know that that works. When you push it, it goes the opposite way. So too is it with God. It's the exact same principle of God science as opposed to man science. Man science looks at it as reactionary. God science looks at it as says actuary. The actuary is the reality that what God says it does, happens, works, is a truth, fact. Reality. One is man trying to understand. The other is God revealing so man can understand, or at least know God. Today we have people that are wavering on everything. They are wavering in their Christianity. They don't know who Jesus is because they'll say, Jesus owns a gun. Jesus owns a sword. Jesus goes to war. Jesus stands for America. Jesus is for Israel. Jesus is not the Son of God. The spirit of Antichrist has gone out into the world. And hereby we know that we are the sons of God. If we say that he has died for us, he lives in us, he is one of us, he is in us, he is someone who we can contact, spend time with, have an understanding of, and have a reality of a relationship that supersedes anything that we could do an interpretation of the Bible. So how do you know you have a relationship? Get alone and get with God on it. Why not? Prove whether or not God is real. Demonstrate to yourself whether or not God is a fact. Go and the extra mile, and nothing wavering, ask of God, who abradeth not for wisdom, and he will show you. God never said that you were supposed to accept anything on fact or on faith. He said, I am, period. You can't please him without faith, because you can't be wavering and go, well, you know, I think he likes this, but, you know, maybe he won't, maybe he does, maybe. You know, nobody likes wishy-washy. You ask them a straight question and you get, huh? It's kind of like with the president even now. You ask, you don't even ask him. You just tell him a fact and he goes, no. Oh. And then he tells you something else. You go, what? And then the next day he changes it. You go, wait. What happened? I woke up. Wavering. I teach biblical prophecy. I teach biblical prophecy today. I write posts. I demonstrate the fact that we have proven for ourselves the probability factors of when Jesus will return. We know specifics within 7 to 10 days about what holidays or holy days, as the Lord says and calls them according to the Jewish tradition, that my people have called them days of the Lord, the feast days, the holy convocations, the times of assembly, the times of focusing our national attention, hopefully worldly, upon God himself, as he has decreed and declared that the fulfillment of those things would be the revelation of his son Jesus. We don't waver. We have not wavered. We've never changed our minds since I got saved. Nothing new has ever been uncovered by me, you know, that doesn't say everything that I didn't already say in the beginning when I first started believing. I question now what some of the things were that maybe I accepted from people as right. Like maybe Chuck Smith a couple times said some things that I didn't agree with then and I still don't agree with now. But I wonder why I agreed even partially then. You know, one of the only, they're nothing major, it's just simply little stupid things like, behold, I stand at the door and knock. It was not used for salvation, it doesn't mean for salvation, it doesn't apply to salvation, it's written to Christians. So, when I was confronted with that, I changed. I went, oh my God, you know, and I was mad about everybody that taught me that, you know. But, call me Jewish. I was deceived, is what I said. So, other than those minor quirks of personality choices and God wanting me to be humbled and humiliated in some ways, but humbled in my own understanding of Scripture so that I wouldn't be prideful or spiteful about what I do know, we don't waver here. We don't want to be tossed anywhere. I don't want to make a mistake or do something stupid because I do enough stupid on my own. I don't have to be stupid about the Word of God, and neither do you. You don't have to have some kind of misunderstanding between you and God. You can be very specific about how you live your life, and quite frankly, you can get your life in order. You could have a personal relationship with God that is so dynamic and personal and real that you could every day see God in the heavens. Jesus promised that. We could be even more so like Him so, we could do so more so than what He did so because He said so. So, what are you going to do? Waver? Doubt? Destroy the fact that He has said what He has said and what He said is what He said? That's the integer that is a fact. The reality is what you do with it. And that is by the Spirit of God. Now, even as this candle that you see over here, I don't know if it'll stay lit now if I pick it up, is going out. It's got lots and lots of wax. Matter of fact, there's a whole pool of wax right there. It's got lots and lots left of wick, all the way down to the bottom of it. But it might go out because it is not trimmed right. It is not cut right. It does not have the stem of the part that should be burning bright where it should be to consume the oil that is being up in it. It is overloaded with oil. It is not in order. As opposed to this candle is burning bright, but it is burning to the left and not the right. Because obviously part of it is burning unevenly. And so it will eliminate itself sooner than it could have and should have lasted longer. We see that this candle is steady and still, and it's even, and it burns slowly down and will outlast all the rest. Will you? Will you pass the test? Will you be wavering to and fro when you see Donald Trump or the President of the United States or the rise of the Antichrist or the rise of the Anti-President or any other thing toss you left and right? Will you march and demonstrate in all the demonstrations that are possible you could get involved in and become a Christian, you know, not evangelist, not apostle, not sharing the gospel, but a Christian, you know, going out and fighting for abortion rights? Or a Christian going out and fighting for the rights and the privileges of animals? Or the Christian is going out to repair the world. Or a Christian is going out to do anything except what God says to you personally. Because I know for a fact that each and every one of you has had God speak to you personally. Romans says it, you know, I mean, they've all known God at one time. They changed the image of the incorruptible God into the image of incorruptible man. Or corruptible man. God speaks, and He doesn't shut up. The question you have to ask yourself, are you willing to listen? And then if you're not, quit calling yourself a Christian. Go call yourself a Mormon or something else, but don't pretend. God hates those that are pretenders. Donald Trump is not prepared for the presidency, so he's an anti-president. Could he rise to the occasion? It depends on his choice, not yours. Could he change his ways and repent and be saved? His choice, not yours. Could he fulfill God's destiny, if that's what God's destiny is, to be an example of what not to be? That can be. Can it be that he could be the example of a man who repents, sells everything he has, gives it all to the poor, and then follows Jesus? Could be. Doubtful, but it could be. But you see, Jesus already talked about these things. And that's why if you don't know the Word of God, my question is, do you know who Jesus is? Because I don't think so. The majority of what people tell me about Jesus isn't the one I've read. I've heard speak to me. I've heard call me by name. I've heard Him speak audibly to me. But it's nothing like the Jesus I'm told in a majority of the churches in America today. They advocate guns rights, the right to bear arms, and Jesus says you have no right to bear arms. You could tell me about some place where He said, go out and buy a sword. If you don't have a sword, go get two or whatever. And then they said, well, wait a minute, we have a sword. Here's one. Okay, that's enough. Or here's a knife. That's enough. And then the priest comes, you know, and Peter grabs with sword, cuts off the ear, and then Jesus uses the sword for what He wanted it for. Demonstrates, no, Peter, this is a lesson. Listen carefully. They that live by the sword die by the sword. Don't carry swords anymore. Do you get the message? Do you get the perspective? Prophecy fulfilled. a physical lesson being demonstrated by a miraculous event, healing the man's ear. Funny how that's ignored as the answer to, should we carry a sword? They want to, because they put their trust in men rather than trust in the Lord. Nothing wavering when Abraham went to take his son to kill him. He didn't waver. That's why he's called the father of our faith. Not because expectations or anything else, or whatever you want to add to it. It's because he didn't waver. God said, take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac, take him to the place where I'll show you 3 days from hence, and take, you know, whatever, and offer him as a sacrifice unto God. Okay. Now he had a chance all the way there to waver, but he told God, even as in James, as we've looked here today in verse 6, he didn't waver. He said, okay, and he went. Didn't stall, didn't ask, well, let me verify, let me get it checked out, you know, let me make sure that it's scripturally correct or authenticated, you know, by 7 witnesses or 10 or 15 or multitude of counselors. But if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and abradeth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven by the wind and tossed. Don't be that. Don't waver. Rather, go to God today and ask him what he has to say to you. Because I think you're going to find that as you ask God what he wants, he'll tell you in no uncertain terms.